I'm really pleased then to introduce our first speaker. Shantae Nelson is the program manager at Wisconsin Voices. She is a leader in multiple areas of fighting for democracy, Democracy 2020, including on fair maps, including fighting against voter suppression and for fair elections in many different ways. Shantae helps to coordinate the efforts of progressive organizations statewide while working to build collective impact towards civic and voter engagement. Shantae Nelson.
Again, Shantae Nelson, thank you all for being here. This is such a great turnout, and we're going to jump right in to this presentation. What I will be talking to you about is fair election maps and fair maps, and it's the basics of gerrymandering 101. It is a setup to prepare us for where we will go tonight, go throughout the night, and it's fun and it's energetic, and what I want you all to do is lean in. We're all in this together, so let's all win together, okay? You all ready for that?
Yeah. Yeah.
All right. So. Have you ever voted in Milwaukee? How many, by a show of hands, if you will tell me, thank you, that you voted in Milwaukee? One of the things that you that we want you to think about is, where did you vote? Did you vote at a local library, a community center? Did you vote in a public building of some sort? So just be thinking about that. Where did you vote, right? And as we do this, what we want to do is we want to begin to talk about some of the things here, and we want to have some fun with this. So. What we're gonna do is we're gonna vote. We're gonna take some time and we're going to vote. We're going to take a vote on, do we support the Twix or do we support the Snickers? Now, in order for us to understand this, we have to understand that we have two runner-ups, two individuals, two pieces of candy who are running against each other, right? They're running a campaign against each other. They both stand for caramel and milk chocolate. However, if you support the Snickers, then you also support that place I can't think of what's in Snickers. Thank you, peanuts. That's what it is. You support the peanuts, okay? And if you support the Twix, then you support, of course, caramel as well as milk chocolate, but you also support the cookie bar, all right? So, by a show of hands, who are supporters of Snickers? Just raise your hand.
Snickers?
Snickers. Snickers supporter, all right? All right, thank you. Keep your hands down. By a show of hands, who would be those who would support the Twix? We sit up here and we say, ooh. Now, this is phenomenal. Okay, so clearly, there were more hands for the Snickers, correct? However, Twix wins. Twix wins. However, although there were more votes for the Snickers, Twix is going to win. And you may say, well, that's unfair. We may say, why didn't the candy with the most votes win? Well, that's what we're going to talk about today. Gerrymandering or unfair voting maps. We're going to talk about that today, and it's going to be fun. It's going to be interactive. So we have an individual. There's a person with a pink tie. She's walking around, and she's going to hand you out some candy. Thank you for participating. That's your treat for me. Actually, your treat for Citizen Action. I won't take that credit. So in order to find out why unfair voting happens in Wisconsin, we have to go back to where we go to vote. What information do you need? And you can yell this out if you want. What information do you need to find out where you should vote? Is it your name? Is it your address? Or is it your driver's license?
Address.
Say it loudly, please.
Address.
Thank you, address. Yes, but why? Why do we need our address? Because we live in a voting district. Voting districts are simply groups of individuals who are grouped together in one voting area on a map. Voting help the people within that group vote to choose who will speak for them in government. All right? So here's a voting district. You can see that this is a representation of an assembly district within the state of Wisconsin. And you can see that it's districts, and each of the lines on the red lines border a district. With this, you can also see that there are some funny shapes in these lines, correct? Do you all see what I see?
Yeah.
Some of the lines are pretty funny. They're not equally drawn. They're not equal squares or equal rectangles or equal triangles. They're a little disconnected, right? So we want to talk about who speaks for you in government. Americans vote for two kinds of representatives or representation. We vote for senators and we vote for senators and representatives, we vote on both a national level as well as a state level. For the purposes of this particular presentation, we're going to go right into honing in on how state level voting or unfair maps will affect us in our everyday lived experience. So who speaks for you in government? In Wisconsin, we have 33 senators, we have 99 representatives, right? So let's imagine we live right here at the library, right here in Washington Park Library. There's a library, there's your home, right? So we live in three different voting districts at the same time in Wisconsin. You live here, you live in three different voting districts. You can click one more time. That's us at the library. You remember, that's Washington Park, it's right behind us. On the side of us, I should say, from where we are. We can vote for a state representative. That is the red line that borders this district here. Or we can vote for a state senator. That's that beige area that's represented there, that tan area. That's a voting district. Now, if we just take a little bit of a pause, I just want to show you something. Because we have 99 representatives and three senators, you have three different districts that will be in one Senate district, three different representative districts that make up one Senate district, right? So with that, we can also vote on a national level. And if you live here in the library or within the city of Milwaukee, you live in a national district four, where those who represent District 4 on a national level, senators and representatives. So really quickly, I'll show you what that means. So your state representative, if you live here, would be Representative Evan Goyke. If you live here, your senator for the state would be Senator Latanya Johnson. On a national level, your national senator, which would be, or national representative, I apologize, would be Congresswoman Gwen Moore. And then your national representation for senators are Tammy Baldwin and Ron Johnson. All right, if you live here, so guess what? That's a lot of voting power. That's the reason why redistricting and gerrymandering is very important, because we have a lot of voting power that we don't always think about. All right? So, does your, and this particular, this is a slight disclaimer. Those whom I just shown, what we talk about, it does not represent them, or it's not a slight to them or any of that. We just want to make a point. So when we ask this question, does your senators and your representatives care about the issues you care about? It is not a slight to anyone we just showed. So that's my disclaimer. Okay? We are all in this together. So you want lead out of your drinking waters? Your representative or your senator can fight in order to get you money to do that. You want safe roads, a grocery store, or the creation of new jobs? Here we are again. Your senator or your representatives can fight to have roads fixed, to attract new businesses, and have good paying jobs. All right? So unfair voting maps can stop you from choosing a representative who cares about the issues that you care about. How, you may say? I'm glad you asked. Through a process called gerrymandering. So, remember those weirdly shaped lines that we had? I'm gonna give us a little bit of a short video that explains it and breaks it down a little bit more. Just pay attention to this one. Hope we have audio. Okay, let's see if we can.
Nope.
No audio?
Geometry. Every state is split into districts. You've got congressional districts, where each district gets one rep in the U.S. House of Representatives. Every 10 years, states redraw the district lines to account for people moving and other population changes. There are two big rules that govern how we draw district lines. Number one, districts have to have the same number of people. And number two, thanks to the Voting Rights Act, districts can't be racist, which means you can't clump all the people of color into one district or spread them out so much that their vote doesn't mean anything. Just to be clear here, racial gerrymandering is not allowed, but political gerrymandering, that's okay. Mathematically, there are like a gazillion ways that you can split a state into districts. Each state has its own process for drawing these lines, and most are done by lawmakers, aka the politicians in power. With the help of computer programs, politicians use population and voter data to make predictions about how different geographical arrangements will likely vote. If they want to guarantee their party stays in power, they can just divide up the districts to squeeze out the other party, pretty much just negating the opposition's votes. It's the reason you get districts that look like a praying mantis or an upside-down elephant. When this happens, you can end up with districts that are mostly made up of one party. So it's really hard to vote elected officials out of office. The opposing party just can't win. Time for a demonstration.
All right. So, we're going to go into a little bit more detail there, right? We're going to break this down a little bit more. So that was, hopefully it gives those in the room who are a little bit more visual a component of understanding what it is that we are saying. What we know, correct? Thank you. So, quick recap. When we look at this particular slide, we can look at districts, that's okay, 21 and 22, which are in Racine, Kenosha. District 22, that's a prime example of gerrymandering right here within the state of Wisconsin. So, we talked about redistricting and how it's a drawing map. It's a map drawn that shows our voting line. However, those maps can be drawn unfairly. So, when we look at unfair voting maps, they can affect our political power. Instead of us choosing who speaks for us, they position us where the politicians choose who votes for them. And that's not what we're about. So what if the politician who chooses you to vote for them doesn't care about what it is that you care about? Gerrymandering goes around the will of the people in order to get a particular election result or outcome. So unfair voting maps, it gives one political party too much power. Democrats and Republicans have done it. They're supposed to balance each other's ideas in order to make sure that the best idea wins, but when one party gets too much power, there's no compromise between the sides, and the most extreme ideas win. So, remember Act 10? How many remember that?
Oh, yeah.
Thank you. Were we asking for our teachers to lose their union bargaining rights? Are we asking for that?
Yeah.
No one said yes, right? Okay. But I've heard someone say yes. Remember right to work? Were we demanding weaker unions for our workers? Remember the big cuts to public education?
Yeah.
Were parents asking for this? Right? However, we received them. These are examples that examples of ways that we were impacted as communities, as it relates to gerrymandering or unfair voting maps. So we're going to talk about three ways that politicians draw voting maps unfairly. We're going to talk about the political, which are unfair voting maps to either side, where either side has too much power. We're going to talk about racial voting maps that are unfair to people of color. And we're going to talk about prison voting maps that are drawn unfairly to communities who have many of their members in prison. So here we are, politically unfair voting maps. Voting maps that can be drawn unfairly against either Republicans or Democrats. Remember, I stated both have been involved with gerrymandering. These maps are deliberately drawn to sway the election in favor of a particular party. Democracy is the rule of the people, and that's what we have to remember. Democracy is the rule of the people. And when the people are not able to rule, then we don't have democracy. And unfair voting maps means politicians rule the people. So here's an example of politically unfair voting maps. And Sachin, I believe, gave us a very good example, but it's a repeat of what he just stated. So yay. Right? 2012, Republicans won only 48% of the popular vote. And 60% of the assembly seats. 2014, Republicans won 52% of the popular vote, 63% of the assembly seats. So no matter what happened in those two instances, there was still a win. So here we are, voting maps unfair for people of color, racially unfair voting maps. Here's an example where in North Carolina, districts 12 and the first district, you can click one more time, were drawn in a way where they were deemed to be unconstitutional. These maps were deliberately drawn in odd shapes for the sole purposes of denying racial groups fair representation in government. This is illegal, thanks to the Voting Rights Act. Census prison-related unfair voting maps, where communities of who have their members, or many members in prison, they're counted. So Wisconsin counts incarcerated prisoners as residents of the areas where they are housed, in that election district. That means that their families don't get public funding they deserve for their children, their schools, their roads, parks, or any of that. So just a quick example. If I look at Sachin and say, you know what, I'm gonna commit a crime against you today. And I am.
This isn't hypothetical.
It truly is, but if I said I'm going to commit a crime against you today, just one back, for just one, we can keep it here. If I'm going to commit a crime against you today, and I am in prison, and I'm deemed to have to serve 5 years, they're going to count. We're going to do the census in 2020, and in doing the census in 2020, I'll get out in 2022. But they're going to count in 2020, and wherever I am, they're going to count me in that district. So from the time I get out in 2020 until 2030, which is 8 years, the resources that should have been allocated to me as an individual will not come to the community that I bring these back into. It will go to the community for which I was counted. So then we look at some of our cities, and here's an example. We look at some of our cities, and in some of our cities, some of our cities experience such a place of disconnect for economic rise because a lot of the people who live in those cities may be in prison when they're counted. And because it's all based on numbers, when they're released back in their community, that money doesn't follow them back into their community. It stays exactly where they were counted. So here's a situation. We have Waupun, 53rd District. And in the process of this, this was a situation where, and if you can click for me because the numbers are up there, it was counted, and 90% of the residents here had the influence of 100% of the people because it was so skewed in their count. Over of the 2,784 African Americans in that district, all but 590 of them were incarcerated. Had they not had those individuals, they would not have met their number for having equal districts around the state. But we have power. How many believe that we have power? It's not just in what we speak, it's not just in what we say, but we have power. We have voting power, we have educational power, we have the will and the power to really get people charged and energized. And so that's what we're doing today. One of the ways that you can change this narrative, we have a Senate bill right here in the state of Wisconsin. Senate Bill 13 and Assembly Bill 44, which requires that voting maps be drawn in a way that's nonpartisan or that can be drawn by an independent group, not a politician. We don't want them drawn by individuals who are tucked away in a room, which we don't know what the process is. You know, this bill includes that they're drawn fairly, that they're drawn in a way where we as the people whom are affected by these maps can have some input and some say in how they're drawn. You can, the postcard that Sachin held up earlier, you can sign that postcard. Just add your zip code and sign your name. Leave it, like you stated, there are postage, there's postage on the card. You can tell people about this process. You can let them know about it, or you can ask us. You can go to the next one. You can ask us, or you can vote as well. I apologize, I skipped one. Is there anyone in here who needs to register to vote? Totally off the topic, but I just want to make sure. If you need to register to vote, please see me, because I really am all things democracy. I really am. Please see me. You can also invite us out to come and speak, or we can help you to be one who takes this presentation around to your communities. This is not something that only myself or anyone up at the front can do. We want to try to get the word out, and we really want to educate people about what's going on. And this is my own personal thing. I always say, you can join Citizen Action. I am truly a partner of our partners. And so these are ways that you can get involved. If you have any questions, we're going to answer some questions at the end, but there is my contact information if you need to contact me. Thank you all so very much.